Pacific winter season comes to an epic conclusion as we crown a champion. Eight of the top players from the Asia Pacific region have gathered to dust off their best decks and duel until only one player remains. The winner earns a spot at the Hearthstone World Championship, a $25,000 first place prize, and of course, bragging rights. Whose preparation, passion, and belief in the heart of the cards will lead them to victory? Pull up a chair and find out as the 2016 Hearthstone Asia Pacific Winter Championship begins.
Hey guys, welcome to day three of the Asia Pacific Winter Championship for Hearthstone. I'm Doa, with me is Brian Kibler, and we have got a lot of awesome games to get through today. In fact, it's the last day. It's do or die time, and by the end of the day, somebody's going to be champion.
Yeah, we had eight players at the beginning of this event. We're down to six. At the end of the day, we'll just have one champion who will win the title of Asia Pacific Winter Champion and move on to BlizzCon for the World Championship.
Yep, that's right. And not only that, right before the finals, we're going to be unveiling a new card from the Whispers of the Old Gods expansion, so that's going to be awesome. Definitely don't leave before you do that. Otherwise, you're going to have to check it later, and then you're kind of behind the times, right? That's enough for us. Let's see what TJ and the gang are up to at the sidebar.
That's right, Doa. I'm TJ, and this is my gang. And we're here at the sidebar. Once again, we'll be breaking down some of the action throughout the final day of the APAC Winter Championship. I'm joined by D2 and Papa Smithy. D2, it's day number three now. Are you excited to finally crown that APAC Winter Champion?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, it's not day two, my favorite day, but day three is pretty good as well. Starting with six players today, five of them at the end of the day are going to be utterly defeated. I'm looking forward to it.
And Papa Smithy, on a scale of 1 to D2, how excited are you?
I'm feeling D3, TJ. I'm really getting up there because it's been just an interesting and a different tournament. You know, the meta that it's evolved here, some of it's been very control heavy. Some people might find that slow, but there's been some real unique developments here at APAC just as we really enjoy ourselves and get into the business end of this tournament.
Yeah, it's been a lot of cool decks, a lot of fun matches. Let's take a look at the schedule for the final day. We're going to start off with the elimination matches and the final decider matches for Group A and Group B. From there, we'll move on to the semifinals. And of course, to wrap up the day, it's going to be the grand finals where we will be punching a ticket for one of these players to the World Championship. We can take a look at the bracket from Group A here, where Handsome Guy was the player to advance in first place from this group. And of course, we'll see Dahune versus UCCU to decide the second player to move on from Group A. In Group B, of course, we saw Pinpingho, who had some crazy matches across the first 2 days of play to move out in first place from Group B. And of course, we'll see the rematch between Naviute and Matsoon to see the second player that's going to move on from that group. And to give you guys a deeper look into the Hearthstone Championship Tour and to give you a better idea of how these players got to where they are, we have Frodan standing by Fireside. Frodan, how's it going over there?
Doing great, TJ. Always enjoy your shenanigans with your sidebar buddies. And I'm really happy to be here on the Fireside, where once again, just in a few hours, I'll be standing next to the champion of the Asia Pacific region. We're going to give them their mug. We're going to give them a check for $25,000. But they're also going to get a ticket to BlizzCon for the Hearthstone World Championship. Now, we recognize that some people may have just tuned in for day three because it's been the weekend and you guys are trying to get ready for the Easter holiday. We want to also let you know about how we got to this point. So a quick breakdown is that seven out of the eight players here, or instead five out of the six, have gotten their spots to the regional qualifiers, to the final player earning their spot in the overall Asia Pacific ranking. That was Handsome Guy for Korea. A lot of epic action that's happened thus far, but I promise today's games will probably be even better. So make sure you get out there on social media by hashtagging HCT, either on Twitter at PlayHearthstone or Facebook.com/Hearthstone. And with that, I think we are ready to go. So let's kick things off with Dahyoni versus UCCU for the first elimination match for the final day of the Asia Pacific Winter Championship.
There he is, Korea's most popular Hearthstone streamer, swaggering up to Handsome Guy. He beckons him over.
Actually a unique thing, you know, there was actually a lot of healthy respect for Handsome Guy from Dione. He's the younger of the players, so usually in Korean culture, he's the one supposed to show the respect.
난 좀 한번 이겨가지고 좀 방심한 것 같은데.
Handsome Guy has the combo, and he's going to go up 2-0 in this series over Dione. Things are not off to a great start for the popular streamer from Korea.
제가 못해서 진 것 같습니다.
UCCU, he does have that Doomhammer and Lightning Bolt to the face, and he is going to take down Staz 3-1.
I feel very good.
A
무조건 세 번 다 이기겠습니다. 不用，我第一场的时候其实就准备蛮多的，然后大概知道他的牌的走向。 데이터 봤는데 제가 유리한 것 같습니다. 他应该是要怕我的，因为我的牌是有点针对他的牌在打这样子。 어 누가 됐던 간에 아마 제가 이길 것 같아요. 왜냐면 자신 있거든요. 不论怎样，希望我们可以打一个精彩的比赛。
All right, well, confidence from both players out of that one. And you know what's funny is that you and I casted the same matchup as, like, the first series in the whole tournament. Now, obviously, Diony won that one, and he won it 3-1, but some of those games were kind of close. What do you think we're going to see
today? There were definitely some razor-thin margins in those games. We saw Diony win one game at one life thanks to Lotheb shutting down the ability for UCCU to draw Lightning Bolt to kill him with Ancestral Knowledge. So this could go either way.
Yeah, totally. I mean, that first game, of course, that Zulok game, you don't survive at one health
just
against
happen.
An Aggro Shaman. Yeah, you're right. That just doesn't happen. But it happened. It happened for Diony in that first game. But that's not the type of thing that you can really count on, you know. But we want to see who you think is going to take that first match. Hashtag Diony or hashtag UCCU when you tweet at Play Hearthstone. Also throw that hashtag HCT in there as well for the tournament. And we'll find out. It's going to be a fan vote. I think it's going to go a little bit towards Diony, but I don't know.
I mean, he is an incredibly popular streamer and won the first match, so hard to argue against it.
True enough, but let's introduce our players. We talked about them. Let's check them out. There is UCCU, starting off from Taiwan.
Hey, UCCU, the Taiwanese player. He did lose that first match to Diony, but came back with a strong performance yesterday and thinks he does have the edge in this match.
Dressing way too warm for the weather, too. I have to say that coat looks a little bit thick.
It's been a little cold, though, actually, around here.
It's true. It's a little bit colder in the studio.
Yeah,
we've got the technology we need to
look at that window. It's snowing.
That's true. It's snowing.
You can see.
Outside.
It's snowing in Shattrath. We're here in Shattrath. I spent a lot of time there, you know, 8 years ago or so.
Me too, back in the day, man. Back during the good old days of the Burning Crusade. Let's meet Diony as well.
Diony, the popular streamer from Korea, who said he got a little bit arrogant after his first win. So we'll see if that carries over to how he carries himself in this performance today.
I think so, too. And he definitely knows it. I talked to him a little bit before the match. He said he still thinks he has a good matchup versus UCCU. He feels like he's going to be able to win just the same as he did a couple days ago. He told me today that he's not worried about UCCU. He's worried about possibly facing Pin Ping Ho a little bit later on.
I mean, these guys did, you know, they come through the same group. They did face each other before in the tournament. So there's no hidden information here. These players have seen each other's decks. They've played against, you know, and seen how they pilot those decks in those matchups. So it'll be interesting if their strategies change in terms of picks and bans and such.
Yeah, that's right. I'm really curious to see especially what decks are going to be banned because we know what happened before, but, you know, has that changed? Let's take a moment and look at our poll results so far, see what the fans think about the results of this match. Looks like it's going to be way over in UCCU's favor. Interesting. Now, of course, UCCU is coming off of that win over Staz, Diony coming off of that loss against Handsome Guy, but I feel like it's a little bit more even than that. Interesting to see that, too, with the fact that Diony won the last match.
It could be the cat people voting.
It could be.
UCCU does have that relationship with his cat. You know,
could be the cat fans.
Exactly. You know, we saw he's taken a few beatings from his cat, but apparently get along quite well. Regardless.
That's true. He told me, though, that his cat doesn't watch his matches, though. He said yesterday he thought it was sleeping. So I don't know. I don't trust that cat. Looks like the bans are, I believe, the same as what we saw on Wednesday.
Yeah, these are the same bans these players brought out. So no real surprises here. I think that this ban makes sense structurally with how these players have devised their lineups.
Yeah, so Druid, Mage, and Warlock for Diony again, and Druid, Mage, and Shaman for UCCU. UCCU, you know, one of the only players to bring that aggro Shaman. Just not a deck we've seen a lot lately.
Yeah, he played the sole Shaman in this tournament.
Yeah.
One of several Tempo Mages, though I believe he's the only one remaining in the tournament with Tempo Mage.
I think you're right.
And I think that both the Shaman and Tempo Mage, they may struggle against the Zoo Warlock from Diony. We saw exactly that happen in the last matchup. But those are excellent decks against Druid, which is, I believe, the goal of UCCU's lineup is to target his opponent's Druid. But Diony is starting with Warlock here, and this is that rematch.
It is.
Of that game we saw where Diony won with just one life, thanks to Lotheb.
That's hilarious, actually. Yeah, they are starting out with the same decks they had in the last match. Diony with maybe not the greatest starting hand ever. He does have the Imp Gang boss, at least. We'll see what UCCU picks up.
I greet you,
And again, the Warriors band, just not destined to see that class in this matchup.
I believe Warrior across all of the championships has been the most banned class.
Seems that way. Control Warrior is so strong right now, and then you do have that threat from Patron as well that's still kind of out there. Gets a Tunnel Trog.
Tunnel Trog is an excellent draw for UCCU. It does contest that abusive sergeant without the threat of dying.
Yeah.
And he could play the Tunnel Trog and use coin to deploy perhaps a Leper Gnome. That would just allow the abusive sergeant to trade, however.
True.
A couple of decisions already for UCCU.
Yeah, I mean, it's really about how much do you want to prioritize protecting this Tunnel Trog, isn't it? You know, because you play the Leper Gnome, because like you said, you'd rather have the abusive sergeant trade with that, but is it worth it?
I think his decision here is whether he plays Tunnel Trog or plays Tunnel Trog and coins Leper Gnome.
Yeah.
Because the Leper Gnome would just get killed by the abusive. If he doesn't play the Leper Gnome this turn, he can just kill the abusive with his Trog,
okay.
And he does decide to go with that.
All right.
Oh,
and wow,
oh,
Daihanyi.
That is a big draw for Daihanyi here.
That is huge.
And because UCCU did not play that Leper Gnome, he's actually behind in the board now.
Yeah, I mean, it's with Aggro Shaman, generally, you do, I feel like, kind of want to throw as much as you can on the board as fast as possible. And while Daihanyi, you know, maybe got a little bit lucky there with that drawing of the Direwolf Alpha, it certainly does put UCCU in a bit of a difficult spot.
Yeah, this is not the greatest position for him. He does have some spells he can cast, some minions he can play. The Rockbiter to remove that Direwolf would give him board presence against Daihanyi. The problem is that he kind of wants that Rockbiter to go with that Doomhammer we see in his hand for big burst damage later on as well.
Well, man, yeah, I mean, when you have that already in your hand, and Doomhammer Rockbiter is such a crucial part of winning so many games of Aggro Shaman, it really doesn't feel good to use that. And he may just throw out that Leper Gnome.
I think he's debating whether he wants to add this Abusive Sergeant to the board as well.
He could.
Looks like he decides against it. Abusive Sergeant can allow the Shaman deck to trade up into bigger minions, like perhaps this Imp Gang boss right here. So now UCCU could remove that. It would leave Daihanyi with an Imp to go along with the Wolf as well. Mm. But this is why the Aggro Shaman deck typically does struggle in this matchup.
Yeah.
The Aggro Shaman deck needs to get in the board and get some minion damage in order to be able to finish the game with its burn spells. But all of its minions just get outclassed very quickly by what the Warlock deck can do.
You know, I think we had the same conversation on Wednesday, too, which isn't so surprising yet. But yeah, I mean, when you're playing that Aggro Shaman into the Zoo Warlock, you suddenly feel compelled to trade. And you never want to trade if you're Aggro Shaman or if you're playing face in general. But in this situation, you got to do it or you're going to get overwhelmed so fast by the Warlock.
Well, it's not even just that you can feel compelled to trade. It's that they can trade into your minions and
that
prevent
too.
Them from damaging them when you need to get that damage in. Because all these cards in UCCU's hand, you know, the Rockbiter with the Doomhammer, the Lava Burst, the Crackle, all of this is great at finishing off an opponent who has taken damage from your early minions.
Yeah.
Not so good when your opponent is just sitting at 30 life, as the Daihanyi is right now.
I think in the end, it still makes sense to trade with this Imp Gang boss.
No.
Oh no, he's
oh,
going
no.
to face, okay.
I think that's absolutely right. Yeah. UCCU does not have the tools to fight for the board in this matchup. He has to try to just get the damage onto Daihanyi and hope that he never finds a Defender of Argus to actually protect his life total. He's going to be falling behind, but if he's able to just get in a little damage here and there, and then he has the big damage that he gets from his hand.
You know, potentially. The funny thing, too, is that he can coin out the Doomhammer next turn and get that just a little bit earlier as well. Oh, two Leper Gnomes for Daihanyi, though.
Yeah, the problem is that now Daihanyi, he has a lot of damage himself, and that damage is adding up really quickly. While UCCU has the burn spells in his hand that can do a lot of damage straight away, the minions that Daihanyi has in play right now can actually just keep hitting UCCU every turn.
Yeah, it kind of seems like you just have to keep going face, don't you? Or do you maybe kill the Alpha, Direwolf Alpha?
I kind of think that UCCU just has to try and pile on damage here.
Yeah.
I don't know how he wins killing minions. Daihanyi is just going to be able to keep playing more minions.
He's just too far. Daihanyi is just too far ahead. But if he does four this turn, he can do 10 next turn with the Rockbiter weapon. He's got a Lava Burst in his hand. Crackle could be big. With a couple more spell draws, he could still win this, theoretically.
I think UCCU has to go face.
Yeah.
He's dead in like two or three turns. If he starts attacking minions, he's just going to put himself in a position where there aren't draws for him to win, and Daihanyi clearly is just going to keep playing things to the board.
Right. Yeah, I think it's Go Face or.
Oh. All right, the side seam. This does cut quite a bit of damage.
It does remove four potentially.
The Direwolf Alpha is a minion that is representing a lot of damage. Oh, there's another one. So.
Oh well, that works. Okay.
More where that came from.
Yep.
And the scary thing about every minion Dianne plays is that it just represents. You know, look at this. UCCU is dead next turn.
Yeah, that should be lethal next turn, and there's just no way that UCCU can do enough damage. And so once again, looks like we're gonna see the Zoo Warlock take out the Aggro Shaman. A little bit less close than the first game we saw, but still a win for Dianne in game one.
Yeah, the interesting thing is if UCCU had drawn a second Rockbiter weapon this turn, he actually would be one mana off of possibly winning the game with that crackle if it rolled max damage just by attacking phase.
It's amazing the amount of damage that Aggro Shaman can do.
It's absolutely outrageous. Once you have Doomhammer, the amount of damage that you can output in a single turn, and in many cases with very, very little mana and very few cards, it's still just, it's so explosive.
Yeah. Yeah, you can pull a lot of games out of the fire, surprisingly. Looks like he's just going to do as much damage to face as he can, I would assume.
He can crackle a minion here, which does reduce the incoming damage, but I don't think there's realistically a way for him to survive.
Wow.
Does take out? Okay. So he has 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, a single minion will kill him from the knife juggler, so. Yeah,
that works. There it is. He's got the Nubian Egg. He's going to have the knife from the knife juggler, and Dianne this time bringing his opponent to one health before finishing him off with that knife, and he's going to take game one.
And that's not unexpected at all.
Yeah.
The Warlock deck is the strongest deck that Dianne does have against UCCU lineup. So getting that win doesn't really shift the chances that UCCU has in order to actually win this match.
Now, to a certain extent, do you think maybe Dianne should have started with a different deck then? Something else that maybe could have beaten the Aggro Shaman and saved that Zoo Warlock for a different matchup?
His Warlock is favored in every single matchup, so it's not really... he has to win with his other decks anyway, so he's going to have to run one of those into the other decks. So at best, he's going to lose with his other deck and then get that deck, which maybe it's one of his other decks will be worse against. It doesn't really add up.
I suppose. Well, meanwhile, Pinping Ho is waiting, watching the match, wondering who he's going to face today. Frodan is standing by with him. Let's hear what they've got to say.
That's right. I'm joined by Pinping Ho next to me, who is well-rested and getting ready for Daymare 3. How are you feeling right now as you go into the final day of competition, Pinping Ho?
I'm feeling pretty good. I was actually a little bit sick on day one and day two, and I have completely recovered right now. I think I'm in my top form.
Ooh, he's in top form. I think the competition should be very scared. Now, you're watching this series. Is there any person you're pulling for?
Not really. I think either one is okay for me.
There's no loyalty to another fellow Taiwanese player in UCCU?
Well, Zach, I have to beat him anyway, so it doesn't matter if he wins now.
Wow, that is ice cold, even to your fellow countrymen. Well, congratulations for getting this far, Pinping Ho. We don't want to take too much time. We'll see who you're going to face off is the winner between this series. So let's send it back over to the desk and get ready for game number two.
All right, thanks, Frodan. Well, I mean, Pinping Ho being Pinping Ho, right? I mean, you really can't expect anything different from this guy at this point.
Yeah, he'll just destroy whoever gets in his path. So.
I guess so.
Doesn't care who it is.
Well, I'd rather not, beat one of my fellow countrymen, so it's better he just loses now, I guess. Wow, Pinping Ho.
Someone else can
hardcore.
Put
hardcore.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're going to go into game two pretty soon. Dianne's got to get a win with the Druid, got to get a win with the Mage. UCCU still all three deck choices to go with. Do you just stick with the Aggro Shaman, you think?
I think that the Aggro Shaman has strong matchups against both of Dianne's remaining decks. It looks like UCCU's lineup is primarily built to target Druid. He has the Tempo Mage, which is pretty much the anti-Druid deck. We did see Druid beat Tempo Mage earlier this weekend, but that's generally why you bring that deck to an event. And here we see starting off with that Tempo Mage, and it is against Dianne's Druid.
Yeah, all right, so looking for a win. With the Mage, we'll see if UCCU can do it and tie up the series. He's got that unstable portal early on. Dianne has been making use of that Raven Idol all week. It's been he's got two of them in that deck, and it's been working out pretty well.
Yeah. UCCU, that unstable portal will be pretty important. No, he does pick up Mad Scientist. That's a very important card. One of the strongest cards in Tempo Mage, and one of the reasons that it does do so well against Druid decks, is Mirror Entity.
Right. Druid decks are built around powering out large minions ahead of time, and if you're able to get a mirror entity off of your mad scientist, you can end up punishing them for giving you something large early as well.
Now, what would you go with here? It's tempting to take another Wrath, of course. Power of the Wild could be strong if you build a decent board, and Claw, probably the least useful out of the three, does go with the Wrath.
The Wrath, I think, is the clear choice. He's going to want to remove UCCU's early minions. The key for Daihini here is to play defense early on. He needs to, he's actually just going to play offense with this Lotheb.
Defense?
And, well, the Lotheb off of the coin here is actually pretty huge. The coin innervate into Lotheb does shut down anything that UCCU can do in his turn right now, though that second Mad Scientist draw is pretty big.
Yeah, gets that second Mad Scientist, but probably wouldn't have minded doing an unstable portal that turn, too. But I suppose turn four, you've got it. Gonna just throw down the second Mad Scientist. And now, with the Lotheb coming out so quickly, and your opponent going into turn three, you probably just hit face with the Mad Scientist, right? You don't necessarily need the Mirror Entity right now.
Yeah, there's not really very many turn three plays out of Druid. Druids generally play Shade of Naxxramas, but you'd often see a Druid perhaps even, well, not in this matchup, innervating out the Shade in turn one, particularly when you have the coin with Lotheb as well. I think just attacking face here makes a lot of sense. There's not a big minion you're going to expect to come down. Just getting in a little bit of damage when you can is valuable.
So you may even want to try to get like a small, like a less threatening minion out of the Raven Idol and just play that if you're worried about Mirror Entity at all.
Yeah, that is one trick that this Raven Idol does offer to Daihini. Interestingly, his hand is full of spells.
Yeah.
We actually have seen Counterspell from UCCU's deck as well. So his Mad Scientists are not guaranteed to give him Mirror Entity.
I think you definitely want to use that Raven Idol before you attack into one of the Mad Scientists, just to make sure, like you said, you don't get counterspelled. Because that Raven Idol may come in really handy for Daihini.
I mean, Daihini has the ability to potentially attack into one of them and Wrath the other.
Yeah.
Which, depending on which secret comes out first,
it's Dr. Boom.
What? Okay. Discover All Dr. Right. Boom. That's interesting. But
wow.
This is Random. This is an interesting decision for Daihini, and he has to make it pretty quickly because the rope just started burning. He does go with the mind control deck. Because Mad Scientist. That's what's in play already.
It's a lot of those, yeah. And he is going to Wrath the other one, but smart to Wrath first before he runs into the Mad Scientist with Lotheb, just to prevent, like we talked about, the chance of that getting counterspelled. Now he knows what secrets are out there, and it's maybe a little bit easier to play around it.
Yeah, the secrets that UCCU has shown from his deck are Counterspell and Mirror Entity. It's possible there's something else hiding in there, but probably not.
Yeah.
They're secret, after all.
That's true. Even secret from us sometimes.
Yeah. UCCU, he has two unstable portals. Could go digging here. He could also just fire off Fireball to kill that Lotheb. That is an okay play because Daihini is behind the mirror entity. Yeah, he does just decide to Fireball. This does keep Daihini from having any real threat, and UCCU has both the Mirror Entity and Counterspell with the ability to play Azure Drake next turn.
Well, I mean, it's not too surprising to see him play that Mirror Entity. It's like we talked about, picking a minion that's not actually going to be too hard to deal with when that Mirror Entity procs.
Yeah, finding something small. Oh, that's an interesting draw.
Yeah.
He is just going to go with Unstable Portal here and gets Druid of the Saber.
Interesting. That card's on the wrong side, man.
Yeah. Daihini actually had the opportunity to pick one of those up with Raven Idol yesterday. So
yeah.
Second time showing up so far in this tournament.
What's going to be? Just going with the stealth, he can trade these 3/3s, and now he's the one with a little bit more board control at this point. Ancient of Lore gets drawn, but Daihini knows that the Innervate would get counterspelled most likely if he plays it.
Yeah, he can play the Innervate, but won't actually be able to get anything off of it. He can't actually play anything this turn because of the Counterspell, or at least nothing productive. The only minion in play is Stealthed, so even the Wrath or the Savage Roar, he could break the Counterspell, but couldn't actually do anything afterwards.
Just going to burn a Savage Roar to activate that Counterspell.
Yep. And I like this because he's going to need to get rid of that Counterspell at some point.
Yep.
I might have actually just used the Innervate to break it at some point because that costs you nothing. But right now, Daihini has no use for his turn anyway, So firing off that three mana, the Savage Roar is probably the worst card in his hand overall.
Yeah, I mean, it's objectively the best choice, I suppose. He's going to use his Force of Nature to clear this board, or to clear part of it anyway. It was just getting a little bit too threatening with not a lot of other removal.
No, but UCCU going into a turn where he's going to have a Mana Worm and quite a bit that he can cast, including a Flame Waker as
that
well.
That Flame Waker is going to do work when it hits the board. If you're Dione, do you think it's worth it to Innervate and Wrath that Mana Worm?
It's definitely a very attractive option here. He has Ancient of Lore, which will allow him to reload his hand.
Yeah.
And frankly, that Innervate, as I mentioned a turn ago, is losing value as the game goes on. As you get more mana crystals, the relative value of Innervate in actually enabling additional plays really goes down. And I think that the Mana Worm is a pretty serious threat right now.
Certainly could be. And you, from Dione's perspective, you should be aware that there's a lot of spells in your opponent's hand. Just the way they've kind of played the game out, it seems like it suggests that a bit. And he's thinking about it. I feel like you should. I feel like the Mana Worm's enough of a threat. He leaves it, though.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised by this play. It's kind of a risk, I think. But UCCU picks up Azure Drake and plays that down with Unstable Portal. What's in the box? Ooh!
Oh, that's a really nice minion to grab for UCCU, getting that Dark Cultist. A way to maybe keep his minions a little bit more durable.
Yeah, and Dark Cultist is actually pretty great here, because he can potentially he can potentially just kill that Ancient of Lore, but one of the big things is it looks like he is going to go ahead and just Wrath this turn, so...
Yeah.
He kind of just took two extra damage from that Mana Worm by not doing it last turn. Seems like he was committed to do it after the play from UCCU this turn regardless.
Pretty much. Well, it's time for the Flame Waker to do its thing, and with that spell power, the Arcane Blast might be enough with the Flame Waker to just finish off the Ancient. It is, right off the bat.
Yeah, and this is a lot of damage coming out. We may even see this Arcane Missiles.
I think we will.
And this does 6 damage. 4 damage thanks to the spell power from the Azure Drake, and then 2 more from the Flame Waker. So Dione is in Ragnaros range.
Yeah, that is pretty terrifying if you're Dione, and even healing with the Ancient Lore doesn't do a whole lot.
Yeah, he is in what looks to be a pretty unrecoverable position at this point. He could play Ancient and heal himself, but he's just kind of dead to the minions on board as well.
Yeah.
He just goes in cat form, but this is not going to cut it.
All right, goes to face, gets a little bit more armor, uses that Living Roots, but...
Yeah, just that Frostbolt in UCCU's hand is just enough to close things out. He can attack both to the face,
yep.
Frostbolt, and there is sort of textbook case of Tempo Mage versus Druid.
It really was. That was about as straightforward as it gets between these two class matchups, or deck matchups, rather.
Yeah, and we saw when the Tempo Mage was able to get a couple of big minions in play, and the Unstable Portal helped that a lot. He was able to generate a board state that had multiple sizable minions. That's really what Druid struggles with.
Yeah, I mean, we know that from a lot of other matchups against Druid. Patron Warrior worked quite well against Druid because you can just flood the board, and then suddenly things like Swipe aren't that good, Wrath isn't that good. So, yeah, worked out well. So they're tied up 1-1.
Yeah, and this is, I think, what UCCU is hoping for. He's hoping that his decks can really prey on the Druid deck from Dione.
Well, both players kind of said the opposite, right? Dione saying, well, I think my decks are good against UCCU. UCCU saying, no, my decks are actually good against Dione.
Yeah, I think that Dione's Warlock deck is great against all of UCCU's decks, but I think his other two decks may struggle a bit. The Druid deck from UCCU still has the Freeze Mage to play against. Mm. It still has the Druid Mirror, which obviously no one's going to be particularly favored, though Dione does have a little bit of tech there with those Raven Idols.
Yeah, that's right. And it's going to be interesting to see how UCCU can get in there and try to get a win with the Aggro Shaman. I feel like that's kind of his Achilles heel to a certain extent in this matchup.
Against these two decks, Aggro Shaman is pretty good. I think Aggro Shaman struggles against other decks that get to the board quickly because other decks that play a lot of early minions can really kill your early minions and you can't quite get the damage in you need. But against Freeze Mage, you have Doomhammer, which is about as nightmarish a card as Freeze Mage can run into, short of keys on Mystic.
That's right. Well, we'll see what they go with as we move into game number 3. Some interesting choices to be made in this best of 5 that's all tied up. And again, it's an elimination round. The winner of this moves on to face Pin Ping Ho. The loser goes home.
Yeah, definitely a big match for both these players. Dione really looking to show that he's not just an entertainer. He's a competitive player as well.
Yeah.
And UCCU, You know, he really wants to demonstrate that, Taiwan is a strong competitive region for Hearthstone.
So we're going to have the Freeze Mage from Daihani versus the Druid from UCCU this time around, it looks like.
Yeah, and Daihani is playing the Torch Mage variant of Freeze Mage. This is a variant that was made popular by laughing. We actually saw quite a bit of it last weekend at the Europe Championship. It tends to be a little more just burn-oriented. Doesn't revolve around Alexstrasza quite as much because it plays the full complement of not only Frostbolt, Ice Lance, Fireball, but also Forgotten Torch. So I think that may make it a little bit better in the Druid matchup, simply because you're not as reliant on getting to that 9-mana spell before you start going to the face. But still, it's an uphill struggle for Daihani here.
UCCU just going to coin out his Azure Drake. He's got a couple Savage Auras in his hand, and with that draw, the Keeper of the Grove, I feel like he's in pretty good shape, at least as far as getting stuff out on the board goes, anyway.
Yeah, this is actually a pretty good start from Daihani. With the spell damage from Bloodmage Thalnos, he's able to kill that Azure Drake immediately and just keep getting damage to UCCU's face.
Yeah.
And this is where the Torch component, the more burn component, of the Torch Mage deck comes in, because all that damage really does matter. It's not like he's just trying to build to a big Alexstrasza turn and then blow you up from 15. He's just chipping away the entire game.
Now, I was wondering if we were maybe going to see the Lotheb that last turn for UCCU to try and kind of give himself some breathing room, but no, it's going to be the Druid of the Claw instead. Do you think this is just strictly to pull out the Fireball?
I think that he is looking to just defend himself. A Fireball on the Druid of the Claw is a Fireball that's not going to his face eventually, but all of this repeated damage is quite valuable here. And this is not the position the Druid wants to be in. The Druid doesn't want to be playing defense against Freeze Mage. That's just not how this matchup typically goes.
Yeah, it's a bit bizarre. He's got a couple options now. He can use the Keeper of the Grove, use that hero power to clear out a little bit of this board. Could also swipe, I suppose, too.
Yeah, you rarely see a Druid swiping the opponent's minions, but I think it might be what UCCU wants to do here.
Yeah, I mean, at least you don't have to worry about the thing that Daihani did in the last match with Mirror Entity anyway. Yeah, not against this mage.
That's not going to come up.
Yeah. So that makes it maybe a little bit easier.
I mean, UCCU, he has kind of an awkward hand. Lotheb is an excellent card, but Lotheb's a great card when you're able to pin down your opponent's ability to defend themselves when you have an aggressive board yourself. Here, UCCU, he doesn't even have a great play for his next turn.
Yeah, pretty much. Just going to use his hero power. Do a little bit of damage to Daihani. Just pop that ice barrier. So doing reverse damage to Daihani, basically.
And Daihani, he's able to just reload this board. You rarely think of Freeze Mage as, you know, reloading the board with minions, but he can actually just play Novice Engineer.
Wow.
Another Mad Scientist, ping your face. He's just going beat towns.
And he's cycling so well too through his deck. He's already building up a really good hand to handle a lot of things Druid is gonna throw at him. Having both Blizzards at this point in the game is really nice too when your opponent hasn't even really started to build anything yet. Not bad.
And the damage is adding up. UCCU, he's down to 21. That's not far from the point you'd be if you'd already been Alexstrasza.
Yeah, pretty much. So what do you do if you're UCCU here? Do you just play that Shade, try to just start building something, maybe Shade Keeper?
I think Shade Keeper is pretty attractive, though the Shade is unlikely to be long for the world, considering the Blizzards in Daihani's hand, and also just how much he's drawn. In UCCU spot, you have to think, okay, there's very likely a Blizzard on the other side of the table, and he has the tools to remove both of them. But the Keeper does get rid of the secret possibility. Oh, he's actually gonna kill it.
I was actually a little bit surprised. I was expecting the silence. That's usually what we see against Freeze Mage.
I had also expected that we would see that used as a silence effect. This does make the board a little bit better for UCCU because his board can't just be destroyed completely by a Blizzard. Oh, and we're not going to see Blizzard from Daihani here.
Yeah, ping onto the Acolyte of Pain. So Daihani just really prioritizing drawing and maybe, you know, just saying this is only 5 damage right now. I've got armor. I can wait until another minion or two come out before I Blizzard.
Yeah, and I can definitely see the logic in that for sure. It does mean that this is potentially a very strong Lotheb turn for UCCU, however.
True. Wrath first on that Novice Engineer. Going to see what he can draw from that. Get some Living Roots. Will it be the Lotheb?
Generally speaking, Lothep is at its best into certain flash points of mana against Freeze Mage. The problem with playing Lothep into 8 mana is that your opponent can just Frost Nova you, but if you wait longer, it's possible your opponent can just play Aggstrasza.
True.
He's actually just going to build up a big board and Hero Power. This is interesting because if he played Lothep this turn along rather than Hero Powering, he has 2 Savage Roars in his hand.
Yeah.
He could represent so much damage with the Lothep effect. I think he could just guarantee a break of Ice Block.
Well, not now. There's going to be the Blizzard into the Doomsayer, and so that prevents these minions from really living too much, and it prevents, theoretically, UCCU from playing anything else. So now he probably won't be able to do the Lothep again.
Yeah, I don't really know what UCCU is saving this Lothep for. That felt like a turn where Lothep just would have been excellent. At worst, your opponent Frost Novas you and is able to neutralize your board. Here, though, he's ended up not only getting his board blizzarded, but there was room to fit the Doomsayer as well.
Well, yeah, especially with what you talked about in that it would have kept your board safe to get that big damage done with Savage Roar the next turn. And I kind of feel like UCCU has sort of set himself back to square one in this matchup now.
Yeah, I think that he may be hoping to save Lothep for a turn where perhaps he's able to protect himself from a burst combo from Daihini. The problem is that he doesn't have an offense going. He's actually just giving Daihini so much time. And when the Freeze Mage player has that much time, they're able to simply accumulate all these resources that will just allow them to keep defending themselves.
Well, by using that Force of Nature on the Doomsayer, that's going to give Daihini a lot more time just in general, because now the combo really isn't even something UCCU can do. It's another Doomsayer immediately in the hand for Daihini. Can do a little bit of fishing with this Arcane Intellect before he decides what to play this turn.
Yeah, I mean, and this is exactly what I was talking about. Daihini, he's at 32 life, and he's free to just cast Arcane Intellect, doesn't really have to worry about this board, it's not that big. And if he does want to kill it, he can just fire off a Torch and Ping and remove everything from play.
Yeah, and he's going to go ahead and use a Torch on that Shade of Naxxramas and throws down the Ice Barrier. So just not really concerned about the 2 damage coming in from the Keeper of the Grove, I suppose.
Oh, and Wild Growth picked up for UCCU, just going to cycle that immediately.
Yep.
And, I mean, he needs to find something. He needs to find Ancient of Lore. That is, that's not Ancient of Lore. That was, looked like another Innervate.
Whoa.
That suddenly became excess mana again. But I believe that's an Innervate.
Should be. Should be. It looks a little bit confusing at the moment. I've never seen this before.
It's a role-playing 0 mana card. It's an Innervate role-playing as excess mana.
See, it's always wanted to be an excess mana. It's like, it's so more unique.
Well, I think that every Innervate, when you have 10 mana already, kind of aspires to be excess mana because it wishes it could draw you a card instead.
I think a lot of players wish Innervate was excess mana when they're at 10 already. That's for sure.
But
there's
now,
the Lothep finally.
And this is just a low impact Lothep because Daihini is under no pressure. UCCU is under no pressure. So this doesn't really create a window for anything. In fact, Daihini has the mana next turn. He has 10 mana. He can cast Frost Nova and still play Doomsayer.
Yeah. Wow. All right. Well, what's it going to be? Gets the Aggstrasza.
Or he can draw that.
It's not the most effective Aggstrasza ever. It just does 5 damage,
well,
but it gets an 8-8 on the board,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it's a big dragon still, and I like that part.
Yeah,
but
well, we'll be long for the world, though.
Yeah, sadly, dragon meets the fate that so many dragons do. Dies to a dwarf with a gun, the natural predator apparently of dragons.
Of everything, apparently. Every large minion. I want to know what kind of gun that is.
Dragons, gods, whatever.
Giants, doesn't really matter.
And now UCCU, he has a big board, but there's Frost Nova plus Doomsayer if Daihini wants to do that. He also could just Blizzard. I think the Frost Nova, Doomsayer, and Ping is what we'll see. We do see 2 Roars from UCCU in the hand. If he does pick up a Swipe, he has the possibility. Or Keeper, all right, that can stop. That's a good draw. But the problem is UCCU is at 12 life already, and there's an Ice Block up already.
He just can't kill him fast enough at this point.
No, he doesn't have a window to really do much that matters here. He had this window in the middle of the game that he chose to spend kind of playing defensive, it felt like.
Now, Daihini seems to be really fishing for that second Frostbolt now. I believe he's only used 1. Would you rather just ping and try to get rid of a little bit of that armor? I suppose it doesn't really matter if the druid's going to armor up anyway or uses hero power rather.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, Daihini, he's looking to assemble that big burst damage, and he still has Not only Frost. Oh.
He just kicked that Keeper of the Grove right down to the board, didn't he?
It's a dragon. It's flying for a little while, you know. It makes a grand entrance. I can appreciate that.
There we go. All right. Well, it's a big board for UCCU.
Yeah, but, I mean, it's going to get blizzarded.
Yep.
It's not really all that threatening at this stage.
There's the Frostbolt.
Yeah. Blizzard, well, Frostbolt, yeah, Ice Lance, Ping.
It's pretty much perfect, isn't it?
Yeah. It sets up a whole bunch of damage here on UCCU. And I believe puts him to 7-6. He actually can draw Ancient of Lore to not die, but that's not Ancient of Lore. He is going to get pyroblasted in the face next turn.
Yeah, I was going to say Ancient of Lore was going to be the only thing that was going to keep him alive for another turn, but doesn't get it. So Dainee going to win in style here in game number 3 with that pyroblast.
Yeah, and this was a matchup where UCCU really felt like he probably had an edge. Druid versus Freeze Mage is usually very much in the Druid's favor, but we saw, you know, Dainee just get so much time that game. He, I think, had maybe 3 or 4 cards left in his deck.
Yeah.
And he was just able to assemble everything he needed.
Well, he got a great start. He was able to cycle through things really quickly, and like you mentioned too, I mean, UCCU just kind of giving him even more time to do it in that case. And that wasn't a game that UCCU was supposed to lose.
Well, his early game was fairly poor. He didn't have great minion presence to actually threaten Daihini early. And oddly enough, he was the one who was using removal spells on Daihini's minions, you know, using swipe to clear off the engineer and such.
You don't see like the aggressive threat of the Freeze Mage very often, do you?
That's not usually how those games play out. But that one did. And now Daihini just needs to pick up a win with that Druid.
Yep, that's right. A win with the Druid would send him to the semifinals. So we'll see if he can pick it up.
Yeah, but this is the class that UCCU, I think, is targeting with his lineup. I think he expected to see a lot of Druid, and he has that Aggro Shaman, which can kind of put a lot of pressure on Druid with the right draws. I believe we actually saw Druid beat the Aggro Shaman deck yesterday with the combo of Living Roots into Wrath to actually kill a Totem Golem, which is kind of what you need sometimes in order to actually win.
It's kind of crazy. Let's take a look at the poll results so far, see if things have changed at all since the last time we checked in. And right now, UCCU is still with that edge, but he's down in this series. He needs to come back.
Well, we did just see him go down in that series. People may not have time to react to that just
That's
yet.
True. That's true. That might be a little bit older data. Well, maybe we'll see again. Well, I don't know. It might end after the next game, actually. So
possible.
We might not get a chance to see that poll anymore. Oh, well. You guys had your chance.
All right, well, we do have the Druid from UCCU and the Aggro Shaman remaining. Druid, that's going to be a toss-up either way. It really depends on how the draws come out and how the players maneuver that matchup. I do feel like the Aggro Shaman has a significant edge, though.
So you think we're going to see the Aggro Shaman?
Well, that's the thing is...
you need to win with both at this point.
Right.
So.
We're at the point where the players have revealed all the information about their decks. There's nothing to conceal, no reason to play your best or worst deck, anything like that. So I think that it's possible we may see UCCU play his strongest deck simply because... if he is going to lose, that he wants to at least go out 3-2 rather than 3-1. It's just sort of a mental thing.
Feels a bit better. It's all about comfort going into this one. And so that means it will be time to go into game number 4, see what UCCU has decided to select for what could be his last game in the entire tournament. Dainee taking him down 3-1 in our first match of the Asia Pacific Champions. Can he do it again on day 3? We're about to find out.
Yeah, players looking very stoic.
Yeah, I know. Well, it's a serious match, man. I mean, UCCU on the verge of getting knocked out. And Dainee, he's had a lot of swagger all weekend, but he is nervous today.
Yeah, I mean, he's been very expressive throughout this entire event. Really had his emotions on his sleeve. And it will be Druid versus Druid. UCCU with kind of a good hand.
Well, I mean, it depends on what you draw into. If you can use those Wild Growths, I guess, right?
You know, Wild Growth is generally the most important card in the Druid mirror. The problem is... that you need stuff to go with it. And right now, UCCU has early plays and nothing else.
Hmm.
So he will be at the mercy of his draws this game. Dainee staring at this hand. If I were him, I'd send all of these back. Nothing here is what I'm looking to have in my opening hand in Druid versus Druid.
Yeah, in the mirror match, you need to ramp like as hard as you possibly can, and none of those cards help you do that.
The dynamics of the Druid mirror really are who is able to get ahead. Sometimes in the early game, just innervating out something big is good enough, depending on how big it is, depending on the texture of the opponent's hand. Often, though, the games come down to just this line of big minions each player is playing, and the player who has Wild Growth typically has the edge there because they are able to consistently play big minions turn after turn.
Well, better looking hand for UCCU for sure.
Yeah, that Azure Drake was a very, very good draw. It does, Ancient of War,
wow.
With the amount of mana acceleration that UCCU has, that can come down fast.
He's gonna get that pretty quickly, yep. And getting a little bit of damage in on Dione, and if you look at Dione's hand right now, it's looking a little bit grim, isn't it?
Yeah, well, the Cycle of Wrath will dig him a little bit farther, maybe find something that will give him an edge, but...
We can coin out the Keeper next turn, I suppose, but...
You see a grimace from Dione as the second Wild Growth comes out for UCCU. That will let him play Azure Drake next turn, and then Ancient of War the following turn.
That's insane. And I mean, when you're Dione and you see your Druid opponent is two mana crystals ahead of you, that's a... It's a rough position to be in.
Well, this Living Roots is not bad for Daihini. It does give him the ability to get something on the board. He could potentially kill an Azure Drake with two of those little guys and the Keeper in his hand next turn.
True. Azure Drake comes in, grabs a Wrath. That's a helpful spell to have. What's it going to be?
Ooh.
Oh, gets an Innervate.
Innervate
okay.
is huge. It can potentially allow Daihini to just play Dr. Boom this turn.
Yeah. Do you think that's the way to go? I feel like it gives you the most board presence. It makes your opponent suddenly have to react to you, where Dione's been the one having to react so far.
The interesting thing is it's not clear that Dr. Boom is better than Emperor.
That's the other question, right?
Emperor reduces a ton of cards in Dione's hand. He has not done much this game, has a really full hand.
Yeah.
And that will allow him to actually just play Dr. Boom with the coin next turn and have a bunch of reduced cards already.
Well, Emperor also makes your opponent react, too. That's a card that you need to get rid of right away, so it will kind of derail UCCU, but it looks like it might be that Dr. Boom after all. It will be.
But the funny thing is we see Mind Control tech in UCCU.
Yeah, that's true.
This could be...
Oh, no.
This could be a crazy MC tech.
No. It's either going to be really good or really bad for Dione.
And Keeper of the Grove, so he could possibly play MC Tech and Keeper if he wanted to this turn. He could also play Wrath or attack into one of those minions. He could just play it safe. The thing is, if you play MC Tech, you still have Wrath, so you can still kill Dr. Boom if
right.
the MC Tech does not take Dr. Boom.
Yeah, I feel like MC Tech first is probably the safest way to go.
Ooh, this still gives him the tool,
yeah.
the ability. He does clear
True.
Off one. So now MC Tech, and what does it take?
What's he grab?
Oh,
okay,
it's a bomb.
Got a
All right.
Bot. All right. It wasn't as good as it could have been for Dione. It wasn't terribly.
Dione breathes a sigh of relief
yeah.
there. But I imagine we very likely might see the Wrath and the Azure Drake trade for Dr. Boom, since UCCU does not have a BGH in sight.
Well, if you don't get rid of this Dr. Boom now, you know, when are you going to really do it? It's feels like it is the time, you know? Dione, though, still going to be able to be the one playing the big minions that UCCU will have to respond to, at least for next turn anyway.
Yeah, the issue here, this was the sort of ramp versus individual acceleration draw. UCCU, he had a lot of ramp, but he didn't actually have something to do immediately with it.
Right.
He had nothing until the second ramp spell. He didn't play like Wild Growth into Shredder into 5-drop, which is really how you get way ahead, which allowed Dione to really get back on the board because he was able to answer the single big play with a bigger play of his own thanks to Innervate. Mm.
Dione going in, just going to trade those Boombots. Okay. All right, well, that worked out definitely better for Dione. Now he's just going to drop that Drew of the Claw. He's thinking anyway.
Where yep. shall I Looks yeah. like a bear will come down. And now MC Tech for UCCU. Not
Saying
really.
It's a drop bear. Papa Smith, you could tell us all about those.
Bears
then,
in the air.
Yeah, Ancient of War comes down. Dione does have Keeper of the Grove. Hmm. So he can turn that Ancient into a much smaller tree. Might as well have uprooted it.
Yep, pretty much. It's going to be a 5-5 at the end of the day, or at least have that 5 health anyway. Which is going to be what really matters. And Dione just run into this with the Drew of the Claw, finish off with the Hero Power, I suppose. Or he can just kind of ignore it completely.
Yeah, I mean, he can just let that 5-5 sit
True.
And attack into the 3-3. Because if he attacks into the 3-3, there's no clean way for UCCU to get a value trade on his bear. If he were to attack into the 5-5 and use his Hero Power, then UCCU could possibly just Hero Power down the bear. And here, that's not an option.
Right. So,
looks like Dione he's debating. Yeah, I think he's debating just attacking into the Ancient, because that would save him two mana next turn if UCC were to attack in. But if his bear were to get Wrath, he would have just taken five damage.
Yeah. Yeah, not worth the risk to Dionysus, so he will go to face with that hero power. Over to UCCU now.
Emperor picked up not the best Emperor, though. We see the Emperor in Dionysus' hand a lot more cards. Only two cards reduced. Reducing Azure Drake is nice because it does give you the ability to fit that in and maybe play the card you draw.
Right.
But Raven Idol.
Oh, I like the Raven Idol. We'll see what he can grab with it. He's got the combo in his hand, too. So if he can get some minions out on the board that stick, he could be in a good spot for maybe getting a big Force of Nature Savage Roar combo.
He might have to use that Force of Nature just to clear the board this turn. Daihani does have both that 5-1 and the Emperor on the board. Force of Nature would allow him to clear the Emperor by itself. He could potentially clear the 5-1 with his 2-4. He may just look with Raven Idol. If he finds, say, Swipe, it might make things a lot better for him, though.
True. Gonna go for it. All right, Wrath, Wild Growth, and Force of Nature. I think an extra Force of Nature sounds pretty good right now.
Yeah, Force of Nature to go with the one in his hand gives him one he can use now, and then a backup that will be able to pair with the Savage Roar down the road.
Yeah, you can use one to clear. Doesn't have to give up the combo. I like it.
Yeah, exactly what he chooses, and he chooses to cast it. So definitely like this from Daihani. Gonna go ahead and clear off Emperor and the Ancient of War, I assume. Yeah, leaving just Shade on the board.
So Daihani with no minions, but clearing a lot of problem ones from UCCU's side. There's the Azure Drake, draws into the Keeper of the Grove. Now this Lotheb.
And Lotheb, I like attacking with Shade now that he's played Lotheb. It means that pretty much everything that could punish the Shade is not really castable by Daihani. And now UCCU has a very strong board presence. Though Daihani is getting an opportunity to get a fairly strong Emperor. Oh, he may be. I don't like this Lotheb if that's what he's going for. Lotheb is playing scared. Lotheb is he's going to go for it, though.
He's worried about the combo, I suppose.
That's exactly what he's clearly worried about. He doesn't want to die this turn to, say, Force Roar. UCCU has such a small hand, though, that I think that when are you going to get an opportunity to get a good Emperor off anyway?
Yeah, I think you can kind of play the odds here.
How much damage does UCCU have? He can play, because of the reduction on Keeper, he can actually kill the Lotheb with Keeper Wrath. And just send all of his minions to the face.
Yeah. It's a nice 13 damage if he decides to go with it. And I think he sees the same thing, so.
Yep.
Will be the Wrath and the Keeper of the Grove. And now it's that dangerous situation where potentially just a Savage Roar could be game-winning for UCCU.
Yeah, this is a lot of damage. Daihani is in pretty big trouble here. He does have Force Roar, but that can't quite clear everything. He's able to Force Roar off the 3-4 health minions, but Lotheb will live.
Yeah, we'll see what he wants to do here. He will clear. Will he go to face with the last one,
though? I think he might be thinking about attacking Lotheb with this in order to make it a potential Keeper target next turn. That does give UCCU quite a bit of damage. Oh, he's actually just going to kill it. He's going to face tank it right now.
Wow.
All right, so he does take a lot of damage there, down to just 7 life.
Well, that's risky because if your opponent draws into a swipe, you're just dead.
He just played Lotheb to play around Force Roar and then just attacked in such a way that he's dead.
Though, I don't know.
The thing is, Lotheb was going to hit him next turn anyway. So killing Lotheb that turn, it doesn't cost him really anything. But it's interesting that he is now sort of in a spot. I don't see a way out of this for Daihani.
Me neither, man. I mean, if you look at this, the amount of health that Daihani has, there's no way that he can stay alive and also produce the board he needs to get back in this game.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like we're going to a game 5, I think, pretty soon here.
It's interesting. If we look back, if he had played the Emperor, he would have reduced the cost of his hand. He would have been able to cast Force, Roar, and Keeper in the same turn, would be able to have a much stronger defensive turn to actually keep that damage off of his face.
That's a good point.
So he played scared with his Lotheb and ended up putting himself in a position where, because there wasn't the Force Roar on the other side of the table, he wasn't dead. I don't think he could beat it anyway, is the thing. Yeah, just from the spot he was in. So Daihani does fall. UCCU now both one game away from advancing here. Both one game away from elimination as well.
Well, UCCU happy that he's going to game 5. A little bit of trouble with the water bottle there, but no trouble in the game so far, taking out Daihani, and we are going to the final game of our first match of the day. The winner of this moves on to the semifinals to face Pinpingho and the loser, the tournament is over for them.
Yeah, and this will be that aggro shaman against the druid. And
yeah.
And we did see UCCU struggle with aggro shaman in his previous matches. It has been the source of most of his losses. But a lot of that has been due to, you know, just kind of things lining up poorly as far as matchups, getting some pretty awkward draws in spots. So I think he's the favorite at this point.
Well, I mean, druid can certainly have a problem with aggro shaman. If you don't get that removal early on to handle it, you can get overwhelmed really, really quickly.
The thing is, though, druid is still druid. Druid still has the ability to just innervate out big things. And frankly, aggro shaman can suffer from some of the same flaws that do plague tempo mage. It's possible that you get those draws that are just a bunch of burn spells, and you're not able to get in enough damage to actually finish your opponent off.
Yeah, well, we'll see if they can do it. It is do or die time for Daihani and UCCU as we go into game number 5 of our first match of the day here on the final day of the Asia Pacific Winter Championships for this wonderful game we call Hearthstone. We didn't call it that. They called it that. But
it's a good choice of name. I like the name.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good name.
We like World of Warcraft, too, though. So.
I played a lot of World of Warcraft in my day.
Me too, man. Well, here we go. Aggro Shaman from UCCU, Druid from Daihani. Who's going to take it?
Well, UCCU has Tunnel Trog already, and Daihani is, we see him just close his eyes and mulligan his entire hand.
Yeah.
He does have Living Roots. Living Roots is a very key card here because it offers the ability to influence the board as early as turn one.
Yeah.
So with Living Roots, he can potentially kill a Tunnel Trog by attacking with the two saplings and using his hero power in turn two.
Now, the Dr. Boom, not the greatest card to have in your opening hand, but like you said, he's got an okay start. Has a hero power next turn. Big Game Hunter can come out and just be a body on the board after that. But what are we going to see from UCCU? Are we going to see just the Tunnel Trog? Yep. That's going to get taken out.
Yeah, the Tunnel Trog, well, this does take up all of, the Innervate.
Oh.
Okay, this could change things.
Yeah.
Previously, I was expecting he would just go ahead and hero power and kill the Trog. Innervate makes the piloted Shredder a possibility.
I kind of like that, because not only do you get the big body on the board, which can trade well, but you also have another minion that comes out of it. So it's, you know, again, it just gives Daihani a way to deny that damage from UCCU.
Yeah, the problem is that the Innervate may, you may need Innervate to play Dr. Boom. You have this kind of heavy hand. This is a matchup where innervating out a big thing can be really valuable early on because it can contest your opponent's board. So when you have the opportunity to use your removal, the minions you have as removal, I think it's a good choice to go with it.
All right, well, UCCU going with that Totem Golem. Big Game Hunter does face it.
And Big Game Hunter is typically not a very good card in this matchup, but it does threaten the Tunnel Trog, but UCCU has that Argent Horse Rider to take it out.
Yeah, and that's kind of a pain, though. But Daihani, he's got Swipe coming next turn, so he can clear this board.
Yeah, he does have the perfect answer to this board from UCCU. We see a bit of a grimace and roll the eyes from UCCU here. Doomhammer is an excellent draw, but
only Totem this turn if he wants to use it.
Yeah, if he wants a Doomhammer next turn, he can't play any spell in his hand because they all have Overload.
Yeah. Yeah, that Doomhammer is such a high priority, though. I say you just Totem.
I mean, this is exactly what we were talking about as far as the awkward draw possibilities of Aggro Shaman.
Right.
You know, UCCU, he had a couple of early minions. They did get removed. And now he just doesn't have the ability to add anything else to the board. And if he does play anything in his hand, he can't play his card next turn.
Well, here's a huge thing with this, too, is that when he probably inevitably just Totems and passes, Daihani can then innervate out Dr. Boom next turn. And UCCU is going to really have to make some hard decisions when he sees it.
Yeah, this is a pretty rough spot for UCCU here. He's got a collection of burn spells, but Daihani is still at 27 life.
Yeah. And going into turn 5, if you've only done 3 damage to your opponent as Aggro Shaman, that is a pretty awful feeling.
Yeah, and that's pretty much a useless totem. The totems that are valuable in this matchup, the most are the Stoneclaw Totem and the Wrath of Air Totem. Spell damage and taunt are very powerful. Arcane Golem.
Okay.
That's another possible damage source. The problem for UCCU here is mostly that it's not clear he's going to have time to play all of these spells in his hand.
Well, this throws off his plan to just do the Doomhammer, too, because now if you just play the Doomhammer, you're going to be taking a lot of damage next turn from Daihani, whereas if you do, like, Arcane Golem and a spell, if you try to kill that Dr. Boom, you know, you delay the Doomhammer, you throw off a lot of damage that could be sent to the face. It's just a really bad spot for UCC right now.
I just don't think you can afford to try and kill Dr. Boom. I think that in this spot, you don't have the damage to win the game, but you have to hope to draw it.
You could draw into it.
Well,
you actually do
have the damage to win the game if you actually can get every hit off of Doomhammer.
Right.
But you don't have that much time because Dr. Boom's in play. So we have seen Elemental Destruction in UCCU's deck, so it's possible that he could draw that, and he might be able to actually get something to clear the board. But it looks like he's just going to go Doomhammer, just going to go to phase. I like this, frankly. It's not necessarily going to be a winning play, but I think it's the least bad option that is currently available to UCCU.
Yeah, I mean, what else are you supposed to do? You're off to the races now if you're the aggro shaman. Dione, though, throwing down that piloted shredder, and he's just going to start doing tons of damage to face.
And this hero power is actually quite relevant. Every time he presses that, he gains a life, and that's the only thing that UCCU can do to win this game is just reduce that total to zero. Obviously, that's the way you win every game, but sometimes your option, you know, you can actually kill your opponent's minions, but that's just not something that's available to UCCU.
Okay, so UCCU kind of calculating things out. How much damage can he do? How quickly? How much overload does he want to work with here?
The crazy thing is that UCCU is actually just dead next turn. We see the Force of Nature in Daihini's hand.
Oh, yeah.
And that represents 6 damage from hand. He has 11, 12, 13 in play. UCCU is at 19. He actually has to kill a minion or he will die to Force of Nature. He's obviously dead to Roar. That's even more damage. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, if he uses damage on this board, he just doesn't have any more damage. You know, he doesn't have enough damage to actually win the game over the next couple of turns. Because even if he kills something now, Daihini's just going to keep playing big minions. So this is... I mean, I wonder if he just tries to kill Dr. Boom here, send some damage to the face, and then maybe hope to just Hail Mary into Ancestral Knowledge, into double Rockbiter to do just a boatload of damage next turn. Yep. So yeah, he does choose to take out Dr. Boom, and this will leave him alive for now. Unless Savage Roar comes off the top for Daihini. It is not Savage Roar, but it's Lotheb.
Lotheb is really good too, man. You can prevent all those spells that are sitting in UCCU's hand.
And it's obvious that UCCU has a handful of spells. We see Daihini just snap that Lotheb off. And we saw Daihini put the pincher on UCCU with Lotheb with his Warlock deck before. And you know, this is already a bad spot for UCCU. Lotheb may make it unwinnable.
Yeah, he's having those flashbacks. There's the Abusive Sergeant. That doesn't really help you all that much, does it?
And Daihini, we see him head down. He's just praying that this sticks.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't think of what UCCU could have here that doesn't involve a spell that can make him. And he can't either. The game is over.
That is it.
Daihini moves on to the semifinals.
He survives. He will face Pin Ping Ho in our semifinal match later on. Took it all the way to the very end. But it's Daihini who comes out on top.
Yeah, and we saw, you know, that aggro shaman deck that UCCU brought, it did struggle. And there, you know, UCCU, he just had what he needed. Or rather, Daihini had what he needed to answer those early minions. Just didn't get quite enough early damage in. And ultimately, Dr. Boom came down early, and that was all she wrote.
That's true. I guess in the end, Thrall was stuck between a Rockbiter and a Horde place.
Yeah, so we see the bracket there. Handsome Guy and Daihini are advancing from Group A. And yeah, we have two people from the top four already. We're going to see who will be joining them next.
That's right. So Frodan is standing by in the fireside with Daihini. Let's hear how he feels after that match.
Don't worry, Doa, I caught that pun. It was glorious. And another glorious victory for Daihini, who moves to the top four. I just want to ask him how he's feeling right now, because it looked like he was under stress coming into it. So just talk to me about some of the emotions as he was going through the match.
아까 많은 스트레스를 보이셨는데 지금 기분이 어떠신가요? 이기셔가지고.
기분은 좋은데 아직까지 끝난 게 아니라서 방심을 할 수 없을 것 같습니다.
He's feeling really well right now, but because it's not over yet, he's still thinking about the next match.
The next match, you'll be going up against Pin Ping Ho, who has, you know, he's definitely done well, but he's also another Taiwanese player. Do you feel like beating UCCU has given you a lot more confidence against him?
다음 상대가 핑핑호인데 대만 출신인데요. 방금 UCCU 선수도 대만 출신인데 방금 이기셔가지고 혹시 좀 자신감 좀 가지셨나요?
핑핑호 선수는 2년 전에 제가 이긴 적 있어서 대회에서 2년 만에 또 다시 만나는데 한번 이겨 보세요.
So he says 2 years ago he actually had a match with Ping Ping Oh and he won, and so he believes he will win again.
Ah, that's right. History does often repeat itself. Well, congratulations, Daehoon-ni. You are going to be moving on to the top four, which means two players from Korea have moved on to the playoffs portion. I guess they are right now the best for now. We'll see what's going to happen. Let's send it back to TJ and D2 and Papa Smithy to break down this match as we get ready for our second series of the day.
Thank you very much, Dan, and welcome back, everybody, to the sidebar. I'm joined by D2 and Papa Smithy, and we're just going to get right into it. It's been pretty evident over the course of the last couple of days that UCCU's been struggling with the aggro shaman list. It's hovering around a 20% win rate for him in this tournament. So, D2, I'm going to come to you first. Was it a bad idea to bring aggro shaman with knowing so much control is going to be here?
Well, hindsight is 20/20. Obviously, like you mentioned, there's a lot of control at this APAC championship, but not as much control in some of the other regions. So maybe it could have helped if he was in a different bracket, maybe if he was a different region. But definitely, looking back on it, bringing that shaman was a bad decision for him.
Yeah, and Papa Smithy, why do you think the shaman didn't perform well? Did it just have those bad matchups? Did UCCU prep too much on ladder or something like that? Why do you think this had such a bad performance?
I mean, the aggro shaman is definitely in keeping what we expected from UCCU. You know, watching the Taiwan qualifiers, you could see that it was likely to be a deck that he brought. But just as we were doing our research on UCCU, we were all obviously watching all the finals from all the regions, and it was clear that at least six, potentially seven of these players had the identity of being those very controlling players. So there was always going to be multiple bad matchups if players stayed same to tight, you know, didn't change from, say, Control Warrior to Patron or Zoo Warlock into Reno Warlock, and that's what they did. They all stuck with their control identity, and thus the aggro shaman was found wanting when it came to good matchups multiple times through this tournament.
Yeah, it could have been a case of being a comfort pick for him.
Sure.
A lot of players, when they come into Conquest, they say, you know, I'm just going to pick the four decks that I have the most practice with. And it didn't work out for him this time. Maybe we'll see a little bit of aggro shaman making a comeback once we get into the spring championship. There's going to be a lot changing from then, but it's going to be cool to see. Let's get into a replay. This is actually from a different game. It's from game three. This was a freeze mage versus a druid clip. And UCCU was playing this matchup really slowly, which you can do sometimes against freeze mage, but Daehoon-ni was putting on a lot of pressure. So D2, why don't you walk us through this line of play that UCCU decided to go with.
Right, exactly like you said. I mean, a lot of times you can play this a bit passively as the druid if, you know, you're kind of going back and forth and it's a passive state in the matchup. But Daehoon-ni was very aggressive, obviously trying to get that damage. And so for UCCU to take a very passive play here seemed like a bit iffy, right? He draws for the card, gets the Living Roots, and basically does hero powers after this, not playing that Lothib. Obviously kind of concerned about maybe a Frost Nova or, you know, maybe Daehoon-ni. He thought maybe Daehoon-ni couldn't do anything but, you know, ping and play one spell anyway. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can kind of understand on one hand, but on the other hand, you basically have to take risks once you're at this point in the matchup. This is a good matchup for Druid, but it wasn't a good state for UCCU.
Yeah, so what he could have done was play that Lothab, and even though he wouldn't have had lethal damage in his hand, Papa Smithy, is it worth it to just put that Lothab down at a time like this and apply pressure?
So once he'd committed to the cycle and got the Living Roots, you play the Living Roots as 1/1s, you put down the Lothab, no board clear outside of, I guess, an 8-mana Frost Nova would have been able to freeze up the board. And then we're talking about over 20 damage worth of pressure. This isn't a matchup. Whenever you're talking about matchups, whenever we're looking at those replays, you're always looking at the texture of the game and what you have in your hand. You have to play to your outs, right? Mm-hmm. That's always the story in Hearthstone. And in this particular game, he had the combo in hand for a very long time. He could have blocked out the freezes in almost every situation, piled on the pressure, and after taking all that early minion damage, you know, already being at a fairly low health total against a Torch Mage, there was no ambiguity about it. He knew it was the Torch Mage that's in a lot of popularity. It just felt like he wasn't the aggressor when he could be and then was left wanting and lost in a favored matchup.
Yeah, and sometimes, even though you can't kill your opponent, it's good to put on pressure because it changes their game plan. And just a little bit of maybe a misstep, but just not pressuring enough when he should have. But thank you guys once again for providing your insight into that matchup. We are going to jump into the second match of the day, which is going to be the rematch, the decider between Matsune and Navi. But before we jump into that, let's take a look at some highlights from the last match.